Scott Kahn from musicplayers.com. Tonight, talking with an amazing keyboard player, composer, music educator, Michael Whalen.
It's great to be here. Thanks so much.
I'm not even done speaking of your accomplishments.
I know. Thanks.
So, this is a man who has over 800 television and film scores behind him, thousands, literally thousands of commercials to his credit, and a solo career as an electronic music and ambient music creator, musician.
Wow.
So much to talk about. Of course, one of the big things we're here to talk about tonight is Michael's new album, Sacred Spaces. Love the fact that we're getting an electronic music album on vinyl. So let's go back to the very beginning. With all this television and film scoring behind you, what led to your career path, going through, music for film and media?
I don't even know. I mean, there was years where I was doing 25, 30 shows a year. So I was just just drowning in work. So, So when you were telling everybody what I've done, it's kind of, when you look back on it, it's kind of like, wow. But when you're in the middle of it, it's just the thing you're doing at the time. But I love working to picture. I still music supervise, and I still do some stuff, but now that I'm so busy with my new career, which we'll talk about, I don't have as much of an opportunity to work to picture, but it's fantastic.
Right. Now, obviously, sound design is a huge part of your method of making music, and we're going to get into that, but again, looking to the past, do you remember the first synthesizer you ever owned?
Absolutely. Arp Omni 2, December 1980. Took it out of its case. I was 14, and not only did I get a synthesizer, but I got about 3 hours in a local recording studio, and I recorded a demo for the Interlochen Center for the Arts in Michigan. And they thought I was going to go there as like a drummer, which I was. I started with percussion and all that. But my idea, because I had, I was really deep into keyboards for like the last 3 or so years, and I got my first synthesizer, and I was like deep into Chick Corea, and I was deep into Keith Emerson, I was like deep into it, Pat Metheny. And I got 3 hours, and I recorded a song where I played all the parts. So in 1980, that was a big deal. And the way I did it was I basically had the song mapped out in my head, and I played the drum part first, and then I put the keyboards, I overdubbed the keyboards on top of it, and that was a big deal. So, and what's funny about that particular song is that 38 years later, this year, I did a jazz record. And I waited 38 years to do this record. So it's me, Michael League from Snarky Puppy playing bass, Vinnie Caliota's playing drums, my buddy, Bob Magnuson's playing sax. And I took that original thing that I did for Interlochen and I turned it into a song called Childish Things. I rearranged it a little. And it's on that album, so.
It's funny.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's funny, that made me think, as you were describing running around the studio, laying down all of the parts, I remember one of the first keyboards, I didn't own it, my friend owned it, but it lived in my house, was the Korg Poly 800.
Oh, so good.
And I had an arpeggiator, and I remember I would come up with some little monophonic line, hit the start button, and run over to my drum kit, and just the ability to play along with it, as a kid was just the coolest thing.
So cool. It was so cool. I love that. I think Sam's probably got one right over there, so.
Yeah, what keyboard doesn't Sam have?
Here we are at Three Wave Music here in Hawthorne, New Jersey, and yeah, he's got even ones I've never seen before like that. I've never seen that SH-101 in Dayglo Green.
How did you learn sound design or synth programming? Did it start by just randomly tweaking knobs, or did you formally come to, when did you come to really understand it?
Okay, so when I was coming out of high school, going into college, I got a Yamaha DX1. So not a DX7, DX1 with the 73 keys and the rosewood sides and the panel and the whole thing. So guys, Google it, you'll say. So the idea is that it was, you know, sort of two DX7s put together, but you could see all the operators and you could see the algorithms in front of you. And so one of the things that happened was I got this instrument with no idea how to use it. So one of the things that happened when I was at the University of Maryland was I got a textbook on Fourier analysis and on FM synthesis, and I read it 30 times. So having that sort of philosophical thing and thinking about how modulators work and all that, I started creating sounds. To answer your first question, I don't think I've ever understood sound design. I think for me, sound design lives in two places. I think there's the sound you're trying to emulate, and then there's everything else. There's like created sound. So, you know, so if I'm working on a car commercial and they want the sound of like a totally like hyped out whoosh as the car goes by. Okay, that's not going to be the sound of a car going by. That's probably going to be like a raft deflating, and then you're going to process it and you're going to speed it up and slow it down and you're going to pull it apart and you're going to add like 30 different things to it. And, you know, then once you got that together, then you're going to resample it and then you're going to like throw something on it.
Okay. So you're part Foley artist as well, it sounds like.
Well, I think it was probably like in 79 or 80, but I saw an early video of Ben Burtt, the sound designer on Star Wars, up on a telephone pole, recording, plucking the telephone wire with a bunch of kids, a bunch of helper guys from Lucasfilm up there doing stuff. And I'm like, what the hell is he doing? And he was plucking the sound so he could speed it up, so that was going to become like the pew, 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 for, you know. And so all of a sudden I was like, so wait a second. So you can create something that you know is the wrong pitch, but you can now speed it up and slow it down, and you can have all kinds of interesting qualities of sound to it at a slower speed, but when you speed it up, the quality of sound changes. So something clicked over in my brain when I was like 13 or 14 of like, okay, that's cool. Like, I don't know what that is, but like, that's the sort of the philosophy that I've brought to every time I make a sound. So whether it's a musical sound, or whether it's a Foley thing, or whether it's like a sound effect replacement thing, because the part of the problem is that when you work in commercials, they call the people who work on commercials sound designers, which is weird because sometimes they're not making sounds, sometimes they're just doing a music score to it. So, but I took that always very seriously. Like, I always wanted to create kind of a unique quality of sound. I wanted the environment to be unique.
So obviously a great amount of care goes into the creation of your sounds. So let me ask you, especially having listened to the new album, and first, let me back up. The new album, for me, when I listen to your playing and your compositions, a little cross between Jean-Michel Jarre, Jan Hammer, and Vangelis.
Vangelis is a huge influence. I mean, Blade Runner, I've seen that movie 300 times, 400 times. It's like a number like that. I remember being in the theater in 1982, and I walked out, and I was astonished at the music to that movie. Like, it literally changed my life. And the whole thing that he did with the score, and then you had the source music coming in, like the Japanese music playing from the advertisements from the outside, and then you had all that stuff. I mean, just the whole sonic world of it just blew my mind. I will out myself right now. I have not really been a fan of, because out of ignorance, of Jean-Michel Jarre until maybe 5 years ago. There was a moment where I was listening to like Oxygen or something, and I was like, this is awesome. This is amazing. And then I saw on YouTube I guess he was touring like in 2007 or something, pretty recently, and he was doing like tracks from that and like and all the stuff he was doing live, and I was just like, I can't believe he's doing this live. And it's not one of these things where it's like 95% of it sitting on a laptop someplace. It's the whole, it's all live.
He brings Sam Storr with him
on
tour.
He's bringing Sam Storr with him. And it's like, I can't believe he's doing that. I mean, I couldn't believe it. And it sounded awesome. I mean, I know it was produced up and he did a thing or whatever, but I was amazed. And so like my respect level for him like grew like 4,000%. So he's more of a recent thing. Vangelis is very, very close to my heart because I think he was one of the guys who, for me, really tied together the sonic sound design thing and melody writing. I mean, I think, you know, Vangelis is one of the great melody writers of all time. And he found this, like, completely seamless way of making these sounds and these textures kind of work where they never got in the way of the melodies. It's always musical, and it's always got, like, a beautiful sort of natural sort of thing to it. I remember listening to Antarctica. And just going, do you believe the sounds this guy gets? Like, is he using the same gear that we, I mean, like, we're all using the same gear, right? And so I think that's another reason why creating sound, spending time, getting stuff out of your sense is so important. It's just, to me, I think, you know, it's great. You can have a synth or whatever, you know, you have Omnisphere and you've got thousands of patches in front of you and whatever. But I think creating a unique voice, creating a quality of sound that's yours, creating an authentic sort of environment where they go, God, that sound, I mean, and that was what Vangelis gave me. It's like, you know, that's got to be part of your voice as a composer. I mean, I even think people like Hans Zimmer, I mean, he's a guy who like walks into a score and he's going to give you a sonic world. He's going to write you themes. He's going to do things. He is a very, 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 very great at dealing with cinematic language, but there's always something sonically that's happening. You know, you listen to Inception and you listen to the horns and you listen to like all the low synths and stuff. You're just like, what is that? It's amazing.
Talk about writing your songs. Does sound design come first, and does the sound that you've created inspire you to write a piece, or do you write a song, or do you actually just sit at a piano and come up with something and then think about the sounds?
Sacred Spaces, it started as a sort of classical project. Now, I've written about 40 classical pieces. A lot of them have been performed by lots of people. Fine. So I had this idea that Sacred Spaces was going to be a symphony. It was going to be like a symphonic work. And then I was like, okay, no, we'll do it as a string orchestra thing. Okay, fine. And I was really deep in a personal conversation about a search for a higher power. So I was like, okay, this is going to really do that. And at a certain point, I ran out of gas because part of me, I don't think, wants to find the answer to, is there a higher power? There's part of me that, like, wants there. I was brought up Catholic, so, like, there's part of me that is actually okay with the mystery of this. And for me, it, like, the project kind of, like, ran out of gas. So a lot of the melodies and stuff, like, went away for 5 years. So a couple years ago, I pulled out some of the stuff I'd written, like some of the stuff. I was like, okay. So I started playing with it again. I was like, this is, maybe we should do this as like an electronic record. So I was like, okay, I like this theme and I like this theme and I like this theme. So like maybe I had like 4 or 5 sort of set 16 bar, 32 bar things. So then I said, okay. Then I stopped that whole thing and I said, let's go make some sounds. And so then over about 3.5-4 months, I made about 800 sounds. Analog sounds, digital sounds, sampled a bunch of stuff, went to people's studios and created drum loops. I did a lot of stuff where I did processed guitar stuff and then threw it into Logic or threw it into Kaima and processed, you know, the daylights out of it. And then once I had a huge palette of stuff, I went back to my themes and said, okay, how do I want to set this? And once that happened, the record, I did the record in like 6 weeks. It just like, it just happened. Okay. So
tell me about some of your go-to keyboards on the record.
Oh, sure. One of the keyboards that happened after almost by the time the record was done is right behind you, the Moog One. I got that synth and I pretty much replaced every pad sound, harmonic sound on the album with that. So I had done a lot of stuff with Arturia, the CS80 plugin, not the CS80, but like a CS80. And then on some of the songs I mixed them together. But the way it's set up, they have done a great job at dealing with the parameters such that if you want to make especially non-tonal sounds, like guys, just sometimes some of you guys need to just get away from the keyboards and just like, let's just be thinking about non-tonal. The Moog One is just like a dream instrument, dream. The Montage, you know, we were talking before, I've been a Yamaha artist for 26 years. I love their pianos, and I've used pretty much every synth they've ever had. I've never owned a CS80, but this one's in my sights. I don't know if I want to tune oscillators for the rest of my life, but it's fine. But I've pretty much owned everything else. The one thing that I really, really, really like about the Montage is it's really fast. So if you've got an idea and you want to access things, it's a great performance instrument. So that wasn't the instrument that I was like going and like building a lot of sounds with. It was more like, hey, I got a cool thing and I have a cool harmonic thing and I'm gonna go do the thing and the thing and the other thing and the thing and boom. So I think one of the things that I do as a composer is I kind of break my instruments into sort of my sort of sonic world stuff and then more like harmonic world stuff, and then sometimes they kind of mutate together. I think what one of the things that that happens to you as a sound designer is you tend to look at sound always in three dimensions. So there's the apparent sound you think you hear in the front, and then there's the stuff that's kind of off to the side, and there's a little bit of stuff off to the side, and there's the stuff in the back, and then there's the reflecty stuff, and then there's the fuzzy thing that you kind of like hollowed out with, you know, EQ or whatever. I think another big go-to instrument for me is a Mini Moog. You know, I've had a weird relationship. I have not been monogamous with with my Mini Moogs. I've had many Mini Moogs, maybe not as many as like Rick Wakeman, but I've had a weird relationship with Mini Moogs, and it has recently stopped. I have a new reissued Model D that I absolutely adore. It sounds fantastic. It doesn't do any of that weird pitch drifty stuff that the old ones used to. It's a great instrument. It feels great. It's so flexible. And I think one of the things that I've also gotten into recently is I've gotten much more into instruments that are performance-based. I've played live a lot more over the last, you know, 4 or 5 years than I have really ever. So I want things that are going to be flexible in the studio, but also going to be quick for me live. So if I need to do a quick change, so got to have a Mini Moog.
Yeah. Now, I noticed a somewhat recent addition to your studio, this beautiful Waldorf Quantum. Yeah. Tell me about your relationship with the Quantum.
So I will say, here we are, it's 2019, the Quantum is announced, and then maybe it was announced like in 2018, and then we waited a year. Yeah, it was announced in 2018, finally happens in 2019, and I'm here at 3Wave, and I'm like, Sam, you have a Quantum. Yes, I have a Quantum. He puts it out, and I'm like, okay. And I remember the first time I played it, I was just like, wow, I love the way this sounds. I love the way this is set up. I love where the parameters are. I love the filter. I loved it. And then I took it home and I was waiting to be disappointed again. And I would say without reservation, this is the best synthesizer that Waldorf has ever made as a everyday, because your question, your original question was, what's your go-to synthesizer? As a go-to synthesizer, like, you can write a song on this. And I think other Waldorf instruments that I have known and owned have been decorative. They've all been like, you know, add the cool effect, add the thing, whatever, whatever. But it's not, you're not going to write a piece with it. The Quantum, you could do a whole album with a Quantum. Like, you know, maybe that might be even like an interesting thing. You know, like, take away the whole studio where the stuff is, like, okay, if you had one synth, what would you use? I would use, with the Moog one. This is kind of an unbeatable combination.
So this is your desert island setup right here.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta say that is kind of an unbeatable setup.
I guess the great way to wrap this up is, so what projects are you working on now?
I have a few projects that I'm going to do as a sort of producer sideman with a couple of our artists. And then in 2021, I am going to start doing another record. But the only thing I can tell you is that it's going to be kind of me with other people. And the other people on the record are going to be some of my heroes from ambient music. So it's going to be I'm really excited about it. Because it's like, for me, it's coming around full circle and talking about, some of these people who like really started my musical life, and being able to like collaborate with them and work with them is like, it's literally a dream come true.
Michael, thank you so much for your time. And for everyone who's watching, again, I want to remind you, Michael's new record, Sacred Spaces, just an incredible sounding, just a musical tapestry. If you're a sound designer, if you're a keyboard player, or if you just love ambient, textural, electronic music, it's just a real sonic treat. I encourage you to check it out.